So Mike the Dome, Mikey Lolo, or Franklin?
Franklin is my government name, I might say, or institutional name. That's what I was called in school, in the penitentiary, or the hospital. Everything else was Mike. Mike the Dome was something that came about in 1980 from my homeboy Tyrone, who just came home from upstate. He used to work at Goldie's on 181st and Audubon. And I went to get a sweatshirt when we used to use Chinese letters. So I got this sweatshirt and I said, I wanted to say Mike in the front and the Dominican in the back, because a lot of people thought I was Puerto Rican back in the 80s. So he was like, the Dominican is not gonna fit, bro. We should just put the Dome, short for the Dominican. And I was like, okay, bet. That shit stuck, bro. For the last 33 years, people still call me Mike the Dome. And Lolo came back in 1985. We used to have this apartment on 173rd. And my homeboy, Boa, started calling me that because I would go in the bathroom when I was taking a shower. And I would start singing. And instead of singing, I would go, la, 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 la. So this shit stuck. So the people that know me from that era, 1985, are the ones that call me Mikey Lolo. But the rest is Mike the Dome. And Franklin is just like, you know, for legal documentation.
So you're a person who's had a long, long, what I mean, like life. Because when we have rough upbringings or rough times, it makes it longer than, you know, longer than expected. So talk to me about being born here in the Dominican Republic and then going to America. How was that experience?
Well, my mother lived in New York in the 60s. I don't know what happened between her and my father that she left my father over at, you know, I think they lived in the Bronx. She left them over there with my older sister, who's like 3 years older than me. And she came down here pregnant with me in 1964.
So basically, if that wouldn't happen, you wouldn't.
I would have not been deported. She came a couple of months pregnant, and eventually I was born here. And my father had to come from New York. Recognized, you know, that he was my father, you know, because over here, if your father don't come through and sign up, you know, you're gonna be a bastard and shit. So that's what basically happened. My mom stayed down here for a couple of years with me, you know, hustling, trying to make ends meet. And then her whole family, everybody was over there, all my aunts and uncles, they were all over there. So there was like, you know, what the fuck are you doing in DR when you know? So she already had a daughter who was an American citizen. So they convinced my mother to go back.
So it's not like now where like it's cool to come back to where you come from, you know, come to DR and just live here. Because a lot of Americans are doing that. They come into DR, they go to Mexico and working remote. It's not like that's, this is when people are dying to go to America.
That didn't exist, bro. Yeah. Because I remember my childhood, man, and, you know, back in the 70s, shit was rough. You know, I was born in 1965. I'm not a young buck. I'm 58 years old. And I remember, you know, from as long as I can remember, you know, we wasn't doing good. Because back in the days, man, you know, my mom's was a hustler. She would do sweets. She would do shirts. She had like 12 sewing machines. Then sewing machines from back in the days that were manual. She had like 12 of those. And she had a couple of women's working for her, and she would do dress shirts and sell it to the stores down here in the yard. So she was always hustling. But the man that she was with at that time, you know, he was like, he wasn't a dreamer. He was like a day-to-day man, so she didn't make nothing out of that. So once she got rid of that man, that's when she decided, you know, I need to go back to New York. So she went back to New York and she brought me along as a little baby, you know, a little kid.
So in a way, you kind of like really grew up in New York. You didn't really have.
I went here to nursery, kindergarten, first, second, and third grade of school. After that, it was all New York.
So you get to New York, and this is the 70s, right?
Yeah, 1974, bro.
And you went to the Heights, but this is when the Bronx is burning.
I didn't know the Bronx at that time. I remember when I got to New York and my uncles went to pick us up, I seen a train passing by one of those elevators filled with graffiti. And I remember my uncles saying, damn, they really covered that one up. So it always stuck in my mind, like, wow, you know, I never had seen a train in my life. I mean, I had seen pictures of my sister who was, you know, here over there in New York, but I didn't know what New York was like, you know, because I was an 8-year-old kid. So when I got there, you know, I went straight from JFK directly to 135th between Broadway and Riverside. So you could imagine a little hick from Santiago. I don't know if you've seen Rio Yaque down here.
Yeah.
Okay. When I seen the Hudson River, I thought I was looking at the Pacific Ocean, bro, because that was a big motherfucking river when I saw that shit. You know, for an 8-year-old kid, the biggest river I had seen was the Rio Yaque. And when I seen the Hudson River, we lived half a block away from it. And, you know, that was my first impression, that train covered with graffiti. It must have been a Queens train or whatever, because it was, you know, coming out of the airport towards Manhattan. I don't know where exactly, you know, exactly where it was, but you know, that was my first impression of New York and the first time I went to a grocery store. I remember once an airplane passed by where I lived and they started throwing out in little plastic parachutes, little bags or like Captain Crunch or something of that nature. It wasn't Captain Crunch, but it was like some sort of cereal. And they were throwing that shit out from an airplane towards, you know, the ground. And the whole motherfucking city was chasing them motherfucking little things. I was a little 7-year-old kid, and I was running after trying to catch one of them things. Man, I think I ate cornflakes once in my life. In those 7 years that I lived down here, once. And I remember we even ate it with hot milk. Turned all mushy and shit. But you know, once I got to New York and I went into that first bodega, it was on 135th and Broadway. Between 135th, 136th, I think they were Cubans. I went into that grocery store, my cousin took me, he's a couple of years older than me. And when I went in and I saw, you know, Chef Boyardee and all these things that I had never seen in my life, I was like, whoa, look at the way the you know, over here they call it colmado. But I was shocked to see so many, you know, products on the aisle. And my cousin, you know, he said, I want you to taste this. And I remember he bought a can of spaghetti and meatballs. Chef Boyardee, man, I fell in love with that. For a little kid, you know, back in the day. Now it's garbage, but back in the days, I was like, whoa, spaghetti in a can. Man, I'm talking about 1974, you know? And then there was this pizza shop on 137, 138, and Broadway. And that was something else. I remember I said it in one of my videos that I seen a drunken couple. They were like munching on this pizza, and I was walking with my mother, and I asked my mom, what are they eating? And she goes, that's pizza, you want to taste it? I said, yeah. Once I tasted that pizza, man, I was hooked for life. To me, that was, I didn't even know what pizza was. You know what I'm saying? Because We're talking about the 70s. There was no such thing as, you know, a pizzeria that I know of back in the days. So I don't ever remember eating pizza down here.
How do you, like, first reach the streets?
I had this friend in elementary school who was older than me. I think he was maybe 2 years older than me, but we was in the same grade. Like, we was in fifth grade together and sixth grade. And I remember I was like 10, 11, and he was like 12, 13. So, you know, you call people like that Rebejillo.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of baseball players ended up in New York with that they're much older than what they say they were. So this kid started hanging out with this gang on 176 and between Audubon and Amsterdam. And he asked me one day, "You wanna get high?" I was 12 years old, bro. And I was like, "I'm what?" He goes, "I'm glue." I said, "Get the fuck out of here." I said, "Yeah." I said, "Well, let's see." You know, I was always a knucklehead, you know what I'm saying? So we went up to the roof, he pulled out these little tubes, put it in a paper bag and started like blowing on the bag, like, and he told me, "Here, do that." Once I did that and I got all loony, I was like, "Oh shit." Right then and there, man, that's it. My life, you know, flipped. And ever since then, you know, it got to the point where I'm now deported.
You start getting high, you know, you start getting into the weed. When do you start going to the heavier drugs?
He took me to that basement where they had the club for that gang on 176. And everybody there was sniffing glue and drinking Night Train and smoking weed. So I kept sniffing glue with him and started hanging out with the gang and stuff like that. And I was between glue and weed for maybe a year and a half. And then when I was 14, I tried acid. I remember we went down to 116 in Lexington and they bought this little piece of paper they call Microdot or Snoopy, because the piece of paper had a little black spot in the middle or a little Snoopy. So you would chew this little piece of paper and you would go, you know, into La La Land. And after that, you know, I just started getting heavier into the streets. I started, you know, committing short little crimes, taking people's money that went to buy weed and stuff like that. You know, when I was 14, that's when shit started getting heavy. When I was 15, this older cat, I remember I was 15 years old. This dude was like 24. And he introduced us to coke. And after coke, he started making speedball, mixing the coke with heroin. And before I came to know, bro, I was a 15-year-old addict, you know? I remember I was working at A&P supermarket, I think they were called back in the days. And I cut my hand with a knife. I was working in the produce department and I cut my hand and I started sniffing plain heroin to take the pain away. And I remember while I had like half a cast in my left arm, I asked the dude, I was like, "Damn, man, I don't feel good." He said, "What's wrong?" I said, "Man, I got a fever and shit, you know? I feel, you know, my nose is watery. I feel like I got diarrhea." And he says, "You're not sick, bro." And I was like, "Yo, you're gonna tell me? I'm the one feeling it." He said, "Nah, you're not sick. You got the monkey." And I was like, "What you talking about? I got the monkey." So I was like, "Let's see." We went, He bought a bag, I remember, on 169. We did it. Once I took that first shot, no more pain, no more fever, no more stomach pains, nothing. And ever since then, I was 15, you know, I just had to maintain that habit whichever way possible.
So because of his addiction, you started, you know, doing what the streets come. Chain snatching.
That was like the easiest thing to do to get quick money. Snatch a chain from somebody walking down the avenue. And back in the days, you know, all you needed to do was walk up and down St. Nicholas or Broadway. And you will have your chain in 10, 15 minutes. Back in 1985, you know, for a young kid like I was, I probably had like the dopest car, you know, for a young kid with the dopest music. Because I had this white Mazda RX-7. And, you know, for a young kid to be riding around in a car like that with the kind of music that I had, I remember, Lisa, Coke Jam was out at that time. Slick Rick and Dougie Fresh had that Lottie Dottie and the show. So, you know, everybody that is from that era remembers Mike the Don and his white Mazda RX-7. Because I had this music system, bro, that used to rock the whole block. When I came around, people knew, oh shit, Mike is coming around. After that, a whole bunch of other people started getting Mazda RX-7 with the loud music system and stuff like that. But I was probably one of the first, and you know, and I was a young kid. By the time I was 15, and we got into heavier drugs, because I remember before I tried heavier drugs, the strongest thing I did was mescaline that they used to sell in Jew Park. They had these cats, they're called the Fat Boys, back in the 70s, 77, 78, 79, and they used to sell mescaline there. And that was like the strongest thing that I had ever done. But once I started, you know, getting into blow, you know, the uppers or the downers and stuff like that, that's when shit got, you know, to another level, because now I wasn't only doing it for recreation, now I was doing it because if I didn't do it, I would get sick. You know, before that, any money that I made from the streets would be used to buy sneakers, sporting clothes. You know, we always used to be riding around in nice bikes. You know, back in the days, they had those Panasonics, those Fujis. And we all had bikes. The little crew that I used to run with, we all had nice bikes. You know how we got them. But that's what we worried about. Once I got into heavier drugs, you know, we needed to support that habit. So you was doing anything you had to do in order to not be sick. And this was a daily routine. Every day you got up, every day you needed to go to the streets to get that money, at least minimum $13.
At that time,
I'm talking about 1980, you know? And between 1980 and 1985, that was my life, you know? Between the streets, between the spots, Rikers Island, the bullpen, Central Booking. December of 1981, I went to Rikers for the first time, C-74. And I was there for maybe a month or 2 months. I don't remember exactly how long I was there. I remember that I came out after Christmas, before New Year's Eve. And that was the first time, you know, that I went there. And, you know, they put me in the two lower. And I used to work at the mess hall, serving food to the other niggas, you know. At that time, there wasn't that many Dominicans going into C-74. And then after that, you know, between 1982 and 1985, I think I went back to Rikers Island two more times, if I'm not mistaken, until 1986, when I really got grabbed and sentenced and sent upstate, you know? But it was a in and out thing, you know, because since I was 12, I was being arrested. I went through the whole process of family court, 6 month probation, 1 year probation, 3 year probation, 5 years probation, you know, being sent to like reformatory schools, schools that wasn't like regular schools, that you would go in there at 8 a.m. and come out at 5. It was like ex-convicts and ex-junkies that used to be like the counselors and stuff like that. And then in 1986, you know, I got sentenced for a couple of bids, but running concurrent. You know, I had a couple of cases put together and I only ended up doing 2 years. At that time, I remember this lawyer came through and he said, listen, your case, you know, you got a warrant and you got 3 different cases here. You know, you got a gun charge, you got you participated in a sale, and you got a warrant for another case. So the best I can do is, if you agree, is have them running concurrent. If you know, cop a plea, like, okay, yeah, I'm guilty. Now, if you go to trial, you know, it's gonna be difficult because you're gonna be fighting 3 different charges. So I said, and how many am I gonna get if I cop out? And he said, I could get you 2 to 4 for this case, 2 to 4 for this one, 1 to 3 for the other one, for the gun charge, and have them running concurrent. You'll only end up doing 24 months. You know, so I was like, okay, back, let's go. So I was lucky in a way because I ended up doing 24 months and came back home. I didn't get deported back in the day.
At this time, are you still on dope?
No. When I got caught in 1986, I was already into dealing in the streets. You know, the RX-7 wasn't part of me no more. I already had gotten rid of that car. You know, I was...
So you had the RX-7 while you were...
I had the RX-7. I had the RX-7 in 1985, in the summer of 1985.
So before we jump around, when did you get clean?
From the habit?
Yeah.
My mom's brought me to DR in December of 1984 with the habit. And I ended up, you know, kicking the habit cold turkey down here. And I started going to a gym. Started working out, eating, you know, because over here it's different. Started eating good, working out. You know, I got big and stuff like that. And I stayed down here for maybe the beginning months of 1985, like January, February, March, April, stuff like that. And then when I went back without the habit, that's when I got into the hustler game. Instead of being, you know, a stick-up kid, I started hustling for my money.
Went from an addict, yes, stick-up kid, now to selling the product.
Selling the product. That's what happened. I started as a strong arm.
Muscle.
Yeah, I was like, you know, like, what's up, you know? I was like that. Yo, Mike, go check and see what's going on.
While you were out here, you know, you had a relationship with another legend.
Yeah.
And is that how you got into?
Yeah. We were friends before that. You know, we were friends since 1977. We were friends when he started. I remember, you know, it all started in a pool room that was on 175th, between 175th, 176th, in St. Nick, out of a dollar with a book of matches. I remember one day he said, yo, man, you think that's about 20 there? I said, yeah. I said, fine. He would put it on, and another dollar for whoever was buying it, and he would give it to him, you know? And that's how it started, you know, selling little dimes, 20s and stuff like that. And, you know, by 1982, homie already had, you know, quite a spot, you know, and he was already making his, man, big time. I started working with them in the summer of 1985, after I came and I kicked the habit, you know, because even while I had the habit, I was still, you know, close because I was from the same block, you know what I'm saying? And I was known.
And this is before crack. So they're not, this they're is not before really crack. Seeing you as a fiend.
No. I was seen because I had a reputation as Mike the Dome, not as a crackhead or anything like that. You know what I'm saying? And back in the days, even though I had a habit with heroin, I would bust, you know?
The same thing right now with the kids, the youth right now, not even the people of our ages too, is that, you know, they're doing the pills, they're doing the lean, it's almost the same shit.
My stuff wasn't no frustration or anything like that. My stuff was, you know, hanging around with the wrong person. You know, a dude that was into it, and he saw how me and my little crew made money and how we always had money back in 1980. So he saw an opportunity to be around niggas that always had money so he could get his fix on. So he started hanging out with us, talking about a dude that was 9 years older than us. So, you know, we ended up, all of us, ended up being hooked on that shit. The whole crew.
84, 85, you had a relationship with a certain human, certain person, and then you get into the organization. How's that?
Well, like I told you, you know, we knew each other since 1977, since I was, 12, 13. And when I came down here and we was hanging out down here, I started working out, and we came out of his club in 1985, summer of 1985, and we went to eat some burgers and, you know, some junk food.
Ain't talking about out here, right?
Yeah. Around the monument at that time, they had a whole bunch of carts that they sold hamburgers.
Yeah, they still do.
And chicken, you know. So we was there eating, and some dudes got stupid with this crowd. His partner, you know, they was into boxing and stuff like that. His partner tells one of the other dudes, "Why are you getting all stupid like that, you know?" And he goes, "Why? What is it? Are you strapped?" So he goes around his waist to see if the dude has, you know, a gun or something like that. And he goes, "Are you strapped? Is that why you're acting like that?" So when he saw a dude didn't have nothing, he just said, "Boom!" Knocked his ass out. So, you know, some of the homeboys charged, like to start a rumble and stuff like that. And I had a scooter at that time. I got off my scooter, and you gotta remember, even though I had a habit, I'm a street hustler. And I have been in the street since 1977. So now that I'm a little bit bulky, I just grabbed one of the dudes that charged, and I was like, you know, bang, 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 bang. And homie saw me doing that. And, you know, we already have been involved in rumbles back in 78, 79, you know, because we were from the same block. And he already had seen me fist fight. I remember I had a fist fight with Papa, who was the president of the Bad Bad Boys back in the days, you know what I'm saying? And he came around my house after that night and he says, "Yo, Mike, man. What's up with you, man? You don't be looking for me or nothing like that." And I was like, "Yo, we two different worlds, you know? You already a big timer. I'm still hustling in the streets." And he says, "Yeah, man, but you know, we We go back. And I was like, yeah, it's true. So he started looking for me here. So we started hanging out, going to clubs, going to the beach, having cookouts and stuff like that, you know? And when he decided to go back, he said, yo, I want you to come back to New York and work with me. And I was like, bet. And he just gave me one condition. Don't do heroin again. Stay like that, the way you are. And I was like, bet, let's go. So ever since we went back, you know, I was under his wing. You know, I was a year, he's like 4 years, 5 years older than me. So I was under his wing, and I ended up living in 173rd and Audubon in that apartment.
And what year is this?
1985, summer of 1985.
So crack is about to come to New York?
It's about to come to New York, because it came a few months later. You know, because at that time it was only blow. And I remember some cats came from Harlem and said, yo, this is the new deal. And he was like, what, really? Said, yeah, so I remember they cooked up like 5 grams.
Mind you, just a little context. You're speaking about an organization that's credited for creating.
No, I'm saying. That's bullshit.
But you were saying from experience that it wasn't created.
No, it wasn't created. It was...
The best way to say it, you guys didn't create it, but you guys were the biggest marketers of it. The way you market.
That's what it happened, you know, because before you had little this and that all over the place.
There was no organization.
No, this dude took it to another new level. He started putting that shit on a plastic bag. He started putting a stamp on it, you know, our name.
So these cats from Harlem come up, they tell you, this is a new wave. This is crack.
Yeah.
This is something we're doing.
I knew it. I mean, I knew about that, but I didn't know it as crack. I knew, you know,
as base.
And I remember when I was doing dope, I remember smoking.
So crack was about to hit the streets in 85.
Yeah.
But it was kind of like base. And you already had experience with base.
Yeah, I already knew what it was. I had smoked it, you know, back in, 82, 83, 84. You know, I wasn't hooked on that. But I knew what it was. I had smoked Diablitos. We used to sprinkle it on weed and stuff like that. And I got to smoke on the pipes. But it wasn't like I was hooked on it, like, you know, like what crack did. You know, because for you to do freebase back in the 80s, you needed to be a money-making motherfucker. Because, you know.
Only like top.
No,
like,
no,
like,
top like, niggas did that,
like
you know.
Like Fox was, that's what they known for.
Look at Richard Pryor. You know, it was like, this was something that people that made money did. You know what I'm saying? And I remember doing it for the first time in, what, maybe 1980? And I really wasn't much into that because I'm too hype. And anything that got me much more hyper than I was, didn't make me feel, you know, comfortable. That's why I think I was able
like
to.
You like down.
Yeah, I was always, I mean, I did heroin, I did Quaaludes, volumes, stuff like that, and weed. But when it came to that, it's not that I didn't do it, but I never got hooked on none of that. You know, I never got hooked on blow, crack, bass, on none of that. Because it was too much for me. Because I always been hype, you know, I was always a hype little kid.
In 85, you guys get introduced into crack from some dealers from Harlem.
Yeah, it was two Dominican kids that, you know, had a spot down there, but they didn't have the backup to, you know, to really get down the right way. So they came to Homeboy, you know, and Homeboy saw the potential. The first time they cooked 5 grams, the two dudes that came left and came back half an hour later with the money. You know how much you need to sell back in the days? Because back in the days, you will have somebody come in. Let me get a line. A line was $10. Let me get two lines. Two lines was 20. Let me get half a gram. That was $50 back in the days. Talking about, you know, back in the days.
That's probably like, what, $1.50 right now, $200?
$100? No, I remember a gram used to cost $100. A gram back in the days. And half a gram, you would need to pay $50. You know? So in order to sell 5 grams, you either need it for a big time customer to come through. I mean, you didn't get nobody coming in buying 28 grams, you know, a quarter, 62 and a half, unless they were dealers themselves back in the days. So all it was back in those days was dimes and 20s. So in order to sell 5 grams, you needed to have a lot of motherfuckers come through buying dimes, because you needed 10 customers to sell 1 gram. You know, 1 gram, $10 a line, you know, you would need 10 customers. You would need 50 customers or less to buy between dimes, 20s, and 50.
And when you're talking about 5 grams, that's broken down. But, you know,
5 grams is
grams. Like they, because I remember one of the things about, you know, cooking crack is that you get more for your bang for the buck too.
Some cats had different recipe.
Oh, so your recipe was probably top.
The recipe you actually lost. You know the way these dudes cooked it, you actually lost, because out of 5 grams, you will probably get 4 grams and change.
When there's other dudes out here, out of 5, they get 8, 10.
They will get the same 5, but it would be like blown up. I don't know what the fuck, you know, I never knew what it was they did, but I knew they used to get like, you know, what's the exact word that I'm looking for? It used to be like marshmallow and shit, you know? It wasn't like that crack that we cooked, which was like, you lost volume, but the pace you got back when it hit you, you know. But there were some other dudes that they would, like, let's use this phone for example. They would put half, and when they would cook it and that shit would like go like grow like popcorn and shit, they would take it off the fire. And you know, it was weaker. But, you know, people used to like seeing this big jumbo motherfucking crap. I remember this is what happened. They cooked those 5 grams. Homeboys left, came back half an hour later. And they came back half an hour later because that's how long it took them, you know, to go and come forward. And then, you know, they cooked another 5 and left. And when homeboys got there, there was already people that had tasted the first waiting for the second batch. So right then and there, homeboy just said, yo, this is the future right here. So at that time, they used to cook with them test tubes. Homeboy bought like a whole box full of test tubes of that shit. 5 grams at a time until they started doing it in the Mr. Coffee pots. And from then on, man,
that's shit life went
crazy.
Now,
yeah, shit went crazy. I didn't get to see, you know, what really happened afterwards, because I only worked summer of 85. I ended up, you know, leaving New York because I had a big record. And like I told you, you know, when I got sentenced, you know, I was running. So I just worked summer of 85 and I came down here. I stayed down here till January of 86.
So you basically wanted to run for the...
Yeah, but not for that.
Not for...
No, because remember, before that, before 1985, I was already a delinquent.
Oh, so yeah, so you wanted to run for the 2 to 4 concurrent.
Yeah, for that thing, I was on the run. So I only worked summer of 85 with them people. You know what I'm saying?
And they come out here.
And then I came down here and I stood down here for a couple of months. When I went back, in January of 86, I went back as a solo artist.
I started. Are you still on the run at this time?
Yeah, I went back.
You go back to.
I went back to New York, and I went solo, because I already knew the business.
So shit wasn't like now, like you could just go back and forth, and it,
yeah, back in the days.
You want to show up that no, this wouldn't guy show got a up. Warrant.
I got busted because of an ex-girlfriend of mine.
We're going to get into that.
Yeah.
So you go back to New York, and you're like, you know what, I could do this by myself.
Yeah, yeah.
So now you trying to build up your own organization, basically.
That's what I was doing.
And at this point, how's the game?
No, yo, if I didn't get arrested.
You would have been.
I could have been a contender. But I ended up, man, you know, the Warren Squad came directly to me, and I was like, how the fuck
but you? So you get back in 86. Right?
Yeah,
you
January.
Get back in 86. Are you in the streets for a little bit or just a couple months and they?
No. As soon as I went back to work.
You went back to trap.
Yeah, so, I went back to work. Okay. I mean, I got there today. The day, you know, next day I was already, I'm over here. Because, you know, back in the days, you could flip out business cards.
I wanna get into that real quick. Because it goes back to what I try to tell the kids and the youth in general, that, bro, if you could go on trap, if you could go do anything illicit, you can become a business person. Because the tactics that you guys used, mm-hmm. even though it's for wrong, mm-hmm. that marketing, mm-hmm. is what Coca-Cola uses, Pepsi uses. Like the marketing you guys use in 85 with no or little to education, mm-hmm. is shit that top Fortune 500 companies are doing. And that's how you guys in a way innovated and changed the dope game, because you guys use those tactics. And that's why a lot of people got rich. A lot of people don't have the money today, or some people do have the money today, whatever decision they made. But what you guys did differently than other dealers, like the marketing ways, like, because why well, is that well, person
while I was working
while that person is perceived to be the creative crack is because of the marketing. Yeah. And when you came back, because you when you was doing your own thing, you was using some of those tactics,
the same thing.
Yeah.
And everybody else that came after. Because, you know, some of the dudes that made a lot of noise, that got books written and stuff like that, I recruited them.
Bro, there's a dude that he goes on Vice, and he's a Dominican kid. Like, and he was a dealer in 2003. And he used that system, but with the technology, where business cards were for flip phones.
Okay.
And he had a whole network off of flip phones. Okay. So imagine, I'm probably copying the same style, but I want you to go into that, like what you guys were doing.
Well, like when I went back, you know, I made business cards, and you know, and you would just give it a name.
Cause the day,
mine used to be Eminem.
Your old name used to be Baseballs, no?
Yeah, yeah.
Baseball.
When I went back, and the name that I put on mine was Eminem. like the candy. Man, for Mike and one of my last names, you know, Mike Mieses. Eminem Jumbos. So, and it hit off as soon as, you know, because I already knew the technique.
And it hit off as soon as. There are beepers in this time frame, so.
Yeah.
Word of mouth.
No. We have beepers. That's, you know, that was the way of communicating back then. There was no cell phone. You needed to walk around with a whole bunch of dimes and quarters in your pocket.
And yeah, and when you come back, you got a spot. You got to, like, you know, you got to.
Yeah, I knew everything. Since I was here, I told homie and his partner, I said, yo, I'm going solo. Good luck. Because remember, even though I worked for them, with them.
He wasn't really.
I already had a name.
So it wasn't like they made you. You was already
No.
You was already made. You was adding on to their.
When I was Mike the Dome, busting niggas' head, they was, you know, working in bodegas. I used to call them hicks. We was talking about that the other day. I was like, man, I remember when we used to come in your building wearing those hick pachuco pants and shit, going to the parties on Saturdays, dancing salsa. He knew that I was gangster before he was a dealer. So there was always that respect. There's still that respect between us.
Even though you're younger.
Yeah, I'm like 4 years younger than him, but I was in the streets longer than him. So when I decided, like, yo, I'm going solo, it wasn't like, no, it was like, it was no.
Because anybody, probably for anybody else, he would have felt offended.
I guess so. Because remember, because look, like I said, like I was the youngest cat with a high-end car back in the days. I mean, it was him and his partner that had the dopest cars, Benz, Audis, and Porsche and stuff like that. And me being younger than them, I was like the third in line that came out with the type of car that would fit my personality. Like I told you, I was more of a enforcer.
Muscle, yeah.
Yeah, I was more like muscle. But you know, when that era came, I used to like bring the work, pick up the money, you know, and I would go alone, strapped. Ain't nobody was messing with me, you know what I'm saying? Because they knew, you know, what I'm not saying like I was unbeatable, but I had a reputation. You know, and that reputation, you know, came along with the work. You know what I'm saying? So people wasn't trying to mess with me, you know? So when I told these cats that I was going back to New York, but I was gonna go solo, you know, it was like, good luck. You know what I'm saying? But like I said, you know, I had this ex-girlfriend of mine who was jealous that I wasn't with her no more.
So how many months were you solo for?
Nobody how many guess. Weeks?
So you go solo. Before we go to that part,
yeah.
I just want to, because you know better than all of us the realities of this shit.
Yeah.
How much money was people as workers were really making every week?
At that time? Yeah. Man.
Was it true that you could make $1,000 a day as a worker?
Hell no. The managers made $500 a week.
And
the dudes inside the apartments, you know, passing the bottle through the keyhole, $350, 1985. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, that will only happen for a couple of months because everybody in that game was hustler, you know? And when it was only blow, you will get a salary, but you know you had your side hustle, where you would use the triple beams and they will ask like, let me get half. And you will get them four lines. Those $10 were yours. So, you know, there was always a side game to the hustle. And niggas used to, you know, make their money on the side. Yeah. So the same thing happened with that. Mostly everybody started working for a salary.
And then they started doing
then, then they started doing, you know, what can we do? Some niggas started cooking their own shit. You know what I'm saying?
How much, because I just want to like to like that myth that like, people was making $1,000 a day.
Nah, that's bullshit, man. Unless you was your own boss.
The boss was making a good, that $1,000.
Oh, no, though, man. I remember one day I went with homie's brother to send something down here on a duffel bag. Do you remember those duffel bags that baseball players would put their equipment?
Yeah.
They would put the bats, the cleats, the gloves. It was like a big duffel bag, but you know, they were long, going with a duffel bag like that, man. And I went, and you know, I went with homie's brother as a bodyguard. And I remember them counting that shit, bro. $150,000, bro. 1985.
And that's a lot of money.
That's back then? And it wasn't like a monthly thing.
I've seen $100,000 in cash.
Yeah.
It ain't a joke.
Yeah.
It takes a lot of cash.
And it wasn't like monthly. I'm talking about this was going on every other day. Every other day, because there was some spots. I mean, after I was gone, that I've heard was, you know, selling that amount a week, and it wasn't only one. You know what I'm saying? It was a couple of spots. So there was a lot of money being sent down here, bro. I mean, I just had that experience. I seen that.
And you know, something that they that people like to say about, you know, us when we was in the streets and stuff, that like we're always dumb. In a way, yes, we might have made bad decisions with our money, mm-hmm. but those guys, they had a way of getting their money out here. But a lot of people, regular people every day who start trapping, they don't know, yo, how can I clean this money? How can I send this money?
Now it's not as easy as it was back then.
But you get what I'm trying to say?
Because back then,
you're trying to make it seem like yeah. we're so stupid because we don't know how to invest our money.
No. Back then, you would go into any multiple service travel agency and they would take your money and give it to you down here. Everybody was into the game. Either you were selling it or you was cleaning or you was, legit people. Down here,
a lot of people rich out there.
Everybody, you know, everybody was making money off that shit. So I've been out of the game for more than
20, 30, no?
95, that's 28 years. 28 years. I've been out of the game. And you know, I used, like you said a little while ago, everything I knew from the streets. I have used it for legitimate business. Same technique.
Same shit.
The only thing that changes is the product.
That's it.
I've done it. I had my own jeans. I had my own computer store. I used to be hooking up call centers down here. How many computers you?
Yeah, that's the hustle.
You know what I'm saying? And my last business was this pizza shop that I actually really gave up on the pizza shop because YouTube looks more promising to me.
Before we get there,
yeah,
we go to we 86 ex-girlfriend calls the warrant squad on you. You get picked up. It's also a life lesson in there when you say that the story of that ex is taking care of you in a way.
Yeah.
And you didn't know that she
was. I didn't know she had a guilty conscience.
And that's why she was taking care of
you. Yeah. She even came down here to my mom's because my mom's was suffering. And she said, don't worry, I'm going to take care of him. You know, I'm going to take care of him. And she took care of me, bro. They used to call me Mikey GQ because I had all the sneakers, all the, you know, there's certain colors you can't wear in prison. But if you could wear them, you know, she will bring me the sweatsuits, the sneakers, the towels, everything. And you know, I had my cell was decorated, you know, burgundy down all over the place. I had my cell had rugs.
You, 86. You doing? Are you doing now the 2 to 4?
The 2 to 4.
Okay, no, the 2 to 4 concurrent. Yeah. At this moment, the next organization that becomes legendary were the kids that were growing up under you.
Yeah. When I did these 2 years, I left them as workers, just like I was.
Those kids were workers just like you.
When I went in.
When you went in.
Okay. That organization got all discombobulated.
The original one.
Everybody went to federal prison. Some, you know, got killed. Others was running down here. I found out through the newspapers in prison
about all everything.
Everything that went down. I was like, oh shit. You know what I'm saying?
And in a way, some people don't look at it that way. But do you think that maybe that whole 2 to 4 going solo, all that stuff kind of saved you from doing big time?
I was happy that shit.
He was like, yo, I could have done 15. I could have done 15 football numbers.
Niggas that were less than me got 35. You know what I'm saying?
In that first organization, were there ever any situations where people turned on each other? Like where there was rap?
No.
That you could say about that one?
No. We were all, you know, original gangsters, man. You know, the crew that I was down with at that time, none of them people, you know, ratted or anything like that. The people that that went that route was the Hicks that homie started bringing down from here. They didn't know the streets.
Yeah, because people they don't didn't know those codes. Here, unfortunately,
man,
they don't really got
they,
that.
They don't know really nothing about that. You
in
know,
some in some hoods, they you got know, that. But.
We grew up at a time that we was like, if you can't do the time,
don't do the crime.
So we knew how the streets worked. You know what I'm saying? Your best bet was you got busted, cop out. What you offering? Such and such year, okay, I'll take it. Don't start going to trial, don't start,
and
you know.
In that time, can you attest? Because that's another thing that they don't have, that honor has lost now too, mm-hmm. is that in that time, you taking that cop out for whatever your organization, mm-hmm. were they taking care of you inside? Or they wasn't?
Well, they were the one that paid for my lawyer.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
yeah, even though I remember I had went solo. So they didn't have no obligations with me.
That don't exist now, too. So that's some people who, I don't condone that shit, but some people who rat, they try to say, oh, but nobody's going to take care of me. But I'm saying, like, back then, there was both of that size. It was the code of silence, and it was honor, where we're going to take care of you while you're inside.
We're going
to show some love to you.
You know, I got a couple of money orders and stuff like that. But when the shit went down the drain, I think it was in 87, that's when the Young Bucks... They took over one of the spots. That's what happened. I didn't know because I was locked up. But they kept looking out. Yo, what you need? I said, like, I'm chill here. I just need I just need to have money for my commissary. And in case I want to buy music, because they allow you to have a...
Was J-Pay back then still? Or no?
I forgot what it was, but I remember there was this like magazine, cheap magazine, that you could buy headphones, Walkman, and you could buy cassettes and stuff like that. So you would order, I think they were in Brooklyn, and you could order, they were like, connected, because they were able to sell to the inmates, and you could buy music and listen to music. So I just needed to have commissary money, because they let you go to commissary, I think it was weekly or every 15 days. I used to get my packages, my salami, my cheese, to get that fried cheese and stuff like that, and bacalao, anything that was hermetically sealed. They could, they could send me, and I always had money. There's businesses that go on inside, and if you wanted to buy something from somebody, all you needed to do was send a money order to whatever address that they gave you. So I always had money on my commissary, And
you're doing your time upstate right now?
I was in Comstock at the time. When that happened, I was in Comstock. A lot of information came through in 1987. That girl that ratted on me died. She fell from a window, broke her neck. We got the newspaper, I remember, 1987. The King of Crack, blah, blah, blah. It was like, oh, shit. Because everybody knew somebody. So everybody was talking, but this was a federal case. We was doing state time. So when I came out a year later, none of the dudes that I was running with was in the streets.
Either dead, jail, or
dead, jail, or fugitive. So I was like, lost in space until I ran in to the Young Cats that were under me in 85.
And this is another legendary crew for so many reasons.
Yeah.
For so many reasons. But did you start trapping with them, or you start doing
your own thing? No. I asked them, because I remember the first day we ran into each other, they ran up on me like, yo, my you know how it is when you come out, you buffed up and shit. So
it's a thing when you were a younger cat and you at the level of your OG or someone you looked up to now be able to embrace them. Like, yo,
yeah,
you outside, yeah. But we came to that bag too.
When I came out, I was 23. I was solid because I was working out in there for those 2 years. And they took me down to the village. And I was like, you gonna buy me some clothes and stuff? He said, nah, nigga. Bah! Buy your own clothes. Homie gave me this.
Here we go. Stack. Yeah, like, oh, shit.
I don't even remember.
What y'all niggas doing?
All I know is that after that day, I was GQ. For the rest.
First fly.
Yeah, okay. I was GQ. First day out, I was GQ after that day, man, because I bought everything. And they were like, I was like, are they using this? Because I was still wearing that polyester suit that they gave your state. You know what I'm saying? I didn't have shit when I came out. My mom's was in DR. So I didn't have shit, you know? So after, you know, we got our clothes and stuff like that. They were shopping too. But their main reason was to hook me up. And after that, I was like, yo, what you got for me? He was like, nothing, bro. Ain't no way in the world I'm gonna have you working for me. That'll be disrespect. Enjoy your freedom, bro. Get you some girls, and we'll be talking. They left me. They said, don't hang out with us. Don't come with us. Just enjoy your freedom. They kept, you know, with their life. And, you know, after I ran out of money, I went up to him. And I said, yo, man, so I need to work, bro. I got to get mines. He pulled out. He said, here. I said, what's this? He said, that's my gift for you. You know what to do with it. I was like, really? Free of charge? He said, yeah. So I went to the Bronx, started cooking up, and I started my own shit, you know? A few weeks later, I was already driving around in a Cadillac. And once that was gone, I went up to him and I was like, yo, I started. He said, I knew you didn't need to be told what to do, you know? Here, grab this.
So at that point, basically became your plug?
Yeah. He told me, here, grab this. Get rich, pay me when you get rich. So now I'm like my nephew who was down with me. He driving around in a Saab 900 Turbo and shit. You know, I got a Lincoln Town Car. And, you know, when I went and I paid him, he was like, that's it. You on. You don't need to, you know, come to me no more. So we will only get together on weekends to go clubbing as friends. You know what I'm saying? And I stood out there for 2 years. 2 years. We was running a block. And I got snitched on again in 1990. And I ended up again. Copy now. What you got to offer? This time it was 3 to 6. I say, I'll take it.
At this point, when you were a worker, how much was the most money you made as a worker?
As a worker? I told you, $500.
And then
1985.
As a boss, how much is the most money you ever made?
Oh, as a boss, I used to make maybe 15 a week.
90, do you land into Rikers at this point first, and then, or is it a fed?
In the 90?
It's stay or fit?
No, I went to Bronx House at this time.
Someone snitched on you, someone of your crew, or?
I was giving work to some kid, and it wasn't from my crew. And I made the mistake of having him come to my stash with his worker. His worker got caught and snitched on him and snitched on me. So that's what really happened. So they busted, you know, this hideout that I had, and I happened to be there that day alone.
It's crazy, because then a couple years, hip hop intertwined the street so much. A couple years later, Biggie come out with the 10 Crack Commandments. That's one of his commandments. Don't bring nobody to the stash spot, nigga.
Yeah, man. I made that mistake, bro. Stupid of me. You know what I'm saying? I made that mistake. And it wasn't actually from my spot. I was just giving this kid some work.
And that shit be hurting the most. Like, yeah. Damn, like, I was giving him, like, I made 50 bands off of these people. Like,
I was giving him some work out of make a profit out of it. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't even my spot, you know? But we ran into each other in the bullpen, and even his father, man, who was an old man, got busted. And he was like, it was such and such person. I was like, damn. You know, he snitched on him. He was the one that brought that dude to my hideout. And we both ended up doing time.
So now you got a 3-6. You cop out to a 3-6.
Yeah.
And you in still state, right? Still state case.
Yeah, state case.
So you back and forth. You go to Comstat for this one, or
no? In this bit, I ended up doing my time in Clinton.
Clinton,
Dynamo. Well, no. Yeah.
So that means that you probably seen the Dominicans turn into what it eventually turned up into.
You know that I met Caballo in HDM in 1990. And he was on the other side of the block where we were. And I ended up on the right-hand side because I ran into this Puerto Rican dude that was with me in Comstock in 1987. So when he saw me, he was like, yo, Mikey GQ, my nigga, homie, what's up? Yo, coming by. He took me to the cell. He cleaned it up for me. He said, yo, man, you part of me. When Caballo found out that a Dominican was on the other side.
With the body.
Yeah, he went. And he said, yo, that's a Dominican here, man. He coming with me to the other side. But this Puerto Rican dude, he from Brooklyn. I remember him, Hollywood. He was like, Caballo, yo, he's my man. Yo, we did time together upstate back in, you know, 86, 87, 88. And he was, yo, bam, bam. And I came and he said, yo, man, I got to get cosa, whatever, whatever. Bam. Nigga was diesel wearing gold chains and HDM and stuff like that. I already had been sentenced. I was already waiting for, you know, for the bus to take me upstate. So I was like, nah, I'm just, you know, traveling through. I came from Bronx House, came down here, and from here I'm going upstate. He says, anything, whatever, whatever. And I ran into Lucas, who also was in contact with me in 87. He from 160 and stuff. And I was only there maybe a week or two, something like that. So when I went upstate, I went into a medium because I only had a 3-6. But I got caught with some shanks. They hit me with a 6 months. In solitary confinement, and from there they sent me to Clinton. When I got to Clinton, I ran in to Caballo's cousin, who's called Emiliano. We was together in Comstock in 87, 88. And he was a hick. I mean, even though he was gangster now, when I met him, he was a hick in the way of talking and everything. And they was calling him Caballo too. So when he saw me on the mess hall, he was, yo, Mike, coño. Like, he was mad that I came back. Cause he was doing a big, you know, he was doing like a 25 to life, something like that. And I was like, what the fuck happened? And I told him, man, one of my workers snitched on me. He goes, damn, what block are you on? And I was like, oh, I'm on C block. Try to get work in such and such place so they could bring you on this side. So you could come to, you know, to the yard on our time. And I said, bet. So when I got to the block where they wanted me to be at, so I could be in the same time frame in the yard, They took me to the court. I already knew how it ran because I had been in Clinton in 87. This is now 91, something like that. So when I seen the switch
from 87 to
from 98. This hick that I met, I mean, we were friends. I'm not saying he was, you know, but, you know, he used to even talk like a hick. But now I see this dude, how his face had changed, how people spoke to him, the respect that he had. And I was like, what the fuck happened in these 2 years that I was out in the streets? And he said, man, we had a riot in, I forgot what prison it was. I know that it was the one where they made the license plate, but right now I can't remember the name. We had this riot, and out of that riot, everybody knew who Caballo was. His name is Emiliano, and he's Caballo, Latin King, Latin Trinitario founder. They're cousins, primo hermano. They even look alike. So I found this out, you know, in the yard. So I was with him there, you know, the rest of my beard for like maybe a year and a half. Together with him, you know, with other dudes, but Trinitarios and that didn't exist, you know, at that time. I had never heard of that, you know what I'm saying? And in 1993, I was sent to Sing Sing. From Sing Sing, immigration picked me up, put my ass down here.
In the streets, you a legend, right?
I am.
I mean, let's talk, let's really speak about it. But you also, not only that, but it's like, you have so many streets-wise. You've been through so many legendary periods and so many legendary stories. Because if you really think about it, we're not going to say the baseball organization.
Yeah.
Then the next organization, you mind if I say the name?
Yeah.
The Wild Cowboys.
Yeah.
You pass through Trinitarios.
Yeah.
Like, It's a lot of points in time. Like you know, the crack era, you got a lot of organization, a lot of legendary names that you pass through, and you know, at the end of the day too, on top of that, it's like, as so far as what I'm hearing and what I know, you had never rapped.
Nah. So that was never like
all of that makes you a legend in the street sense, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's just what we came up from and what we grew up from. But all that, it leads you to come to DR because you get deported.
Yeah.
Before we get into that, you as a person who did all your bids, you never told anybody, how do you feel about people snitching on people? At least thinking back, I know your life has changed now, back to that.
Nowadays, you know, I see that, you know, times have changed. You know what I'm saying? So people is gonna work their way around of getting less, even if they have to screw somebody for it. You know what I'm saying? And the reputation of a lot of people talking shit on social media. Snitches get stitches. This and this and that. That's only on social media. Because ever since the Italians started doing it, where big bosses were snitching on their bosses and stuff like that, who are Dominicans? They're not even organized. Or Puerto Ricans, for that matter. They're not even organized the way, you know, these families were. So nowadays, a lot of niggas is doing it. Most get away with it because state time, they don't have their paperwork like the way federal time do. You know, I've known a lot of details about federal because most of these cats from baseball that did 10, 15 are still friends of mine. And they show me their papers and they tell me how it works in the federal prison system. You cannot come in there and walk around in the yard
until you have your paperwork. And sometimes you gotta wait the 30. Sometimes you know, take 30 days.
In state, niggas do it. They do their time in protected custody, and they come home like if nothing happened. And who's gonna give the stitches? The bitches that be on Instagram saying snitches get stitches? They don't do shit. Cause I seen, you know, niggas that came home that did some foul shit. And what happens? With those same people that say snitches get stitches, seeing them taking pictures with, you know what I'm saying? So I don't know what happened. I mean, there was never a reputation that you could say, oh, homie got taken out. And you will say, like, why? Ah, he ratted on, you know? That snitches get stitches thing came from Rikers Island, from people cutting people's face and stuff like that. But it wasn't even because of snitching. It was because niggas was doing that, you know what I'm saying? Because they was foul.
I mean, if you really look at, listen, I don't fuck with that rat shit just because of how I grew up. I had a lot of older people in my life who taught me a certain honor system in the streets, and I don't fuck with that. But that being said, I still see that there's a lot of politics in this shit because people pick and choose who they label a rat and who they accept the rat in. You know what I'm saying? Like, you ratted because you felt your life was in danger. Oh, that's okay. It, like, you either gotta accept it or not. Either or. But
they got it by category.
Yeah.
Like Tekashi 69.
He's good because they
Tekashi 69 versus
Gunna now. Now versus Gunna. Because now it's a whole mess.
Yeah.
But then that day, I've seen it. I've seen how some guys, I don't know in your era this happened, but like towards the 2010s to my generation, it's a lot of CIs too. A lot of guys who they getting funded by the feds to live the life.
And they
infiltrate.
And like, I heard about that.
We've seen it. Like, a certain people go from crew to crew to crew to crew, and you're like, how they never get booked? It's been 10 years you've been dealing dark drugs, and you went from crew to crew to crew to crew, and you've never done a bit.
Yeah.
Let's be real, bro. You know this game.
That's crazy.
You know this game. But I'm just saying, because you have an episode coming out soon with someone who's been a little controversial. And I want people to come see that episode when it does come out.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll probably get all those details
that
people in the streets been asking.
Mm-hmm.
So you wouldn't have a problem with, again, sitting down with somebody who's been accused or known for that?
I consider him my friend. I consider him my friend because he took care of me while I was inside and when I came home. I visited him before the shit hit the fan. And he was afraid of what was gonna happen because of what had happened in the streets. He was in prison at the time. He was doing maybe a year for some shit in C-76.
Yeah, because it was really tough. Like, it was really bonding. Yeah. It was bonding people.
So I visited him and you know, we spoke. And he was worried of what was going to happen because he was going to get labeled as the boss. And whatever happened in the streets, they was going to try to put it on him like he was the one giving orders or something like that. So he was really scared
because of
that
shit,
because he didn't have shit to do with that. I mean, they did some foul shit while in the streets. But what really, you know, what really hit the fan, the shit hit the fan, was that triple four whatever thing that happened. And at the time, you know, I was in prison, I got deported. And, you know, I went back in my own way and I visited him out of loyalty and respect before the shit hit the fan. So we spoke and he told me how nervous he was of what was to come. The case had not exploded yet. You know what I'm saying? But he was afraid that he was going to be pulled in. After that, you know, I came down here, you know, I gave my life to Christ because it was the only way that I saw myself getting out of the streets, you know? And what happened afterwards, you know, it was very few that said, fuck it.
Give me the 30, give me the...
Give me the 30, give me the 50.
There's a person that I know of in that situation who I think got like 130. You probably know what it is, by those numbers.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's real, it was real numbers.
Yeah.
And the thing is, at the end
football
of the day,
numbers.
At the end of the day, you know, what anyone can say about anybody, everybody has their own opinion. I just feel like if you sat there and did your time, you know, whether you think it's dumb or not, you know, like you gotta respect you no matter what, because you did your time. But I still think that in the place where we are now in our lives, that it's, even though I don't agree with snitching, that it's good to hear the perspective so the kids can see like the realities of the streets.
Yeah.
Shit ain't all niggas, like, bitches and cream.
Listen,
you know what I'm trying to say? Like, people will turn on you.
I feel like it got to the point. So, you know, I can't speak on a first-person basis because I wasn't there. I wasn't part of that organization, even though I was linked to it in a way. Most were fighting for their life. Because even though if you're doing 130, 50, 60, whatever, you're dead. Yeah. You know, you're a dead man walking. So most of these niggas was like, you know, trying to get out the casket. And some got some skip bits. Some are here deported. Others were born, you know, in the States, still living over there. But, you know, homie did 27. You know what I'm saying?
But he still got that label on him.
Yeah, but it's
like it just takes away all your legendary status.
Yeah,
you know?
It does.
And you
know,
let's be real, like,
in
like
a way.
No matter you how know much that, money you,
you
made,
know that, you know, out of respect of our friendship, I know this, but I will never speak to him about that.
And I respect that.
I will never, because he knows I know what's being said. He knows I know. But my love for our friendship won't let me either call him that or talk about that, because our encounters when he comes down here is based on our past. You know what I'm saying?
Every day you change your life.
Yeah, it's based on our past. What you did to survive, even if the reputation has been tarnished, does not affect me in any way or shape, is the way they say, any which way, shape or whatever.
Shape or form.
Yeah. I'm still gonna show you my love. You know what I'm saying? What you did, you know, what am I gonna do? Am I gonna be the one to give you the stitches? Like, you know what I'm saying? Some of us, you know, we got a group on WhatsApp where most of the baseball and Cowboys are in it. You know what I'm saying?
Before we go there, did you ever meet Carlito Navaja that's out here doing the content now? That he was part of the
Trinidad. Tio Carlo?
Tio Carlo.
I know him on the phone.
That would be like, yeah, that would be great.
We
content.
Are supposed to do content together. Him interview me interview him
be,
and stuff
that
like
would
that.
Be great.
But he lives in Puerto Plata. You know
that
what
would
I'm
be
saying?
Great. Yeah, that's like three hours.
Look at the group. Yeah, it's right on top. If you see some of the names on that group, you will say, "Oh, if I could get interviews
of all them,
from these niggas, my channel will blow up." My channel will blow up, man. But it is what it is, man. You know, I feel like
some of them went that route of like, "I'm not ratting, I'm taking my time," and they may feel a certain way.
I know about one that worked for me in 88. His name is Teso. I know about him because his sister has a kid with my homie Castro from 177. And homie went to court with his wife because his brother-in-law is involved. Teso was offered, what, maybe 15 years, something like that, to cop out. He said, nah. He went all the way and got 50 and better. He's doing it like if nothing happened. The one that got 150, I don't want to mention nobody's name, 150 or whatever, felt innocent, took it all the way, and for the system, he was, you know, guilty. So by losing trial, he got all them years. You know what I'm saying? Whoever took that a trial, with all the evidence either made up or real, you know, got fucked up. Everybody else.
Yeah, there's another cat too who got, they say they got fucked up in the situation, but that's the only person that I feel like, because there was one cat that he claims he was never there in the triple shit. You know, the other kid, the one that's a little younger, mm-hmm. than the one that's doing 100, mm-hmm. the other one's doing like 50 or 40. Mm-hmm. And it's like, I know some of his family too, like they it's just street shit. Like,
and to be honest with you, homie wasn't there neither. But he got caught up in the game.
And it's the game. That's why I want to show the kids. Yeah. It's a fucking game, bro.
Yeah,
it comes. It. That's why I be saying like the reason I don't fuck with Rash, right?
Yeah.
Is because I feel like the moment you step into this game, you abide by the rules of this game.
Yeah.
So once you say, well, this rule is not good enough for me, mm-hmm. well, guess what? You just broke the code. So that's fine, break the code. Mm-hmm. But don't ever claim that you was a street legend ever again, because you stepped in. It's like when you join a gang.
Oh,
you join a gang, you join a gang. Like, you know what comes.
You see the name of the group, right? You know there ain't nobody in that group with that type of reputation.
With what, Ryan? Nobody's around. No, sorry, nobody.
Nobody will go in this group if you got that type of reputation.
That's not something I want to know.
Because the main niggas, you know what I'm saying, that were part of this history is on this group. You know, if I show you some of the names, you would like, damn.
I'll be like, damn, Mike, I know you can't get the interview, and I'll try to get the interview.
Oh, man, but we just took a lot of shit. They be sending a lot of, you know.
Nah, but it's everybody,
everybody's, you know, grandfather now. And
That's cool. They got that relationship.
Yeah, yeah. And it happens to be like that because of, you know, the reputation that we maintain. We took care of business when business needed to be taken care of, and we were men. You know what I'm saying? I'm close to being 60, bro. I'm 58 years old. You know what I'm saying? I'm not no young kid. And some of these cats is 62. So we're not talking about babies. I mean, we were 20 and 24 in 1985. You know what I'm saying? But nowadays, I'm just trying to put food on the table for my kids. And trying to give them a better life. You know, I got my kids in drama school. My young boy is already a musician. He plays drums, he plays guitar.
And you guys do concerts together. I like that.
Yeah, yeah. I'm trying to get him, in case I die, so they could keep this YouTube shit going. You know what I'm saying?
Before we get there, you say you, after you did the last bid, you get deported, you go back to New York, come back, you find God.
Yeah.
How was that experience for you?
I had a problem in Homeboys Club. Some dudes got stupid because I don't look the role. When I wear a dress shirt, I look like a legitimate businessman. So some dudes got stupid, and I ended up cracking his head open inside the club with my 9mm.
Out here?
Yeah. That was December of 94. I got arrested. I got taken in.
You had a restaurant spot? Or they?
No, right there in the club. Because, you know, it was filled with... That club was always somebody in there. You know what I'm saying? There was always undercover in that club. So I got arrested. They got arrested. So when we was in the bullpen down here, you know, all that Rikers Island technique came out.
Out here is different,
yeah,
bro.
I was like, yo, what's up? We ain't got no guns now. What you wanna do? Give me them cigarettes, motherfucker. So they was like, damn, this nigga ex-con. They noticed, like, you know, this nigga's been in prison before. So they was like, yo, I'm sorry, man. The alcohol, whatever, whatever, blah, blah. While I was in there, you know, after the alcohol left and I came out the next day, I was like, am I gonna come down to DR to be Mike the Dome from New York? Remember, this is December 1994. I had just come home in 93. And in 93, I went right back. And I kept on hustling. 93, 94, I was hustling. So I said, I can't do this, man. You know, I already had a son. He was a couple of months old. He was 6 months at the time, my first son. So when I came home the next day, I grabbed my son and I said, damn. I was traveling at the time. I was like, damn, if I keep this shit up with my son in my hand, another man is gonna raise you. Cause I'm either gonna die, and if I get busted again, as a persistent, I'm gonna get life sentence. You know, whatever, whatever, with life behind. So I say, how could I get out the game for real? Because I knew once I ran out of money, I was gonna go back. You know what I'm saying? So my neighbor at the time, you know, got touched. And I, you know, freaked me the fuck out, because homie was one day talking about girls and guns. And the next day he's talking to me like, Jesus loves you. I was like, nigga, you lost your mind. So I was like, you know, I went to his house and I was like, what the fuck happened to you? Fine. He started talking to me. And then I told my wife at the time, I said, let's go to church. Let's see what happens. And we went to church, I remember, January 5th or 6th of 1995. And I just said a prayer in my heart. I said, if I come out the same way I came in here, I don't want nobody to talk to me about this bullshit no more. But damn, something happened, bro. When they say, who wants to accept God as their Lord and Savior? I was like, I raised my hand like I wanted to. I don't know what happened to me, but I just started crying and asking for forgiveness. I was like, oh my God, forgive me. I didn't know this was like this. And ever since then, you know, I just started, you know, serving the Lord. So what I did was with those paperworks that I had that I used to travel with, I burnt them. So I said, if I have them, even though I'm a Christian,
I'm out.
I'm out once I don't have no more money. So I burnt it. That was January, February of 95. Never been back. Been down here. Now I'm a YouTuber.
As a person was deported and you changed your life, how do you like start making money and start like trying to
cheat? Well, I used the same techniques that we use in the streets. I started working legit. I asked God, you know, in order for me to stay down here, you need to get me a legal job. And I got a legal job. I remember as stock boy in a warehouse. From there, I got a better job at Liz Claiborne. Liz Claiborne used to give work down here to the Free Zone. And, you know, since I was a hustler, I started getting offers of better jobs. And I started working in 95. By 1998, I had my own little factory. Because once I learned the business, I said I could do this shit myself. Because I noticed, yeah. I noticed what they did, you know. I said, the brands, okay, let's say a brand that everybody knew.
Timberland made out here.
Yeah, Timberland. Okay. But let's talk about jeans, because that's what I did. Levi's. What did Levi's do? Levi's came down here, found a Free Zone.
What is a Free Zone?
A Free Zone is a closed industrial park that ensembles shirts, t-shirts, jeans, Timberland, and everything that you wear in the States is done in the Free Zone. It's an industrial park, it's closed. You know, in order to go in, you need to go in through customs. In order to come out, you need to go come out through customs. So I started working in that field. So when I saw what they were doing, they would come down here and get factories or corporations to offer them a full package. What's a full package? Okay, you send me the fabric. You send me the thread, the buttons, the zippers. I will ensemble the jeans for you, and I will put it in a container and ship it to you to wherever you want, Florida, New Jersey, Delaware.
At a cheaper price than the States.
At a cheaper price than in the States. The same thing they do in China, ensemble shit. So I saw that. I said, So I bought $15,000 worth of denim. I bought buttons, I bought zippers, and I bought labels, and I bought thread. I went to a factory, and I said, for how much are you gonna ensemble that for me? What I did was I got the patterns, I bought the clothes, and I put together a little warehouse where all I did was cut the fabric, take it to a factory where they will ensemble the jeans, and then I will take it to another factory where they will wash the jeans, stonewash, and give it to me, you know, folded with the labels and everything. And then I will go out and try to sell it to the stores down here.
And this was like your own brand?
That was my own brand, bro.
Like with your own logo?
Old logo. It was called Abba Jeans.
And you was trapping jeans
now. I was selling jeans, bro, just like I was selling crack.
And is that like the base of
that's how everything works, man, you know? All those labels, everything that you see, that Tommy Hilfiger, Levi's, Lee, all the brands, that's what they do, bro.
How do you get into YouTube? Because I know it's through, in a way, it was through being Christian and having your own broadcasting, no?
I always got bullied as a kid for having for my voice being like, you know, I remember when I was a kid, they would call me Ronque Pavo.
Oh, yes,
because,
right.
Because I would, you know, always sound like Froggy. Remember Froggy from the Little Rascals? He was like, hey, kids. So in 2015, I was already down here, you know, I have forgotten about New York. I mean, I still cherish the memories. But now we you know, with all these videos that you see, I just Whenever I want to see New York, I just go on YouTube. Yes.
And before this period, you were surviving off of the businesses that you established.
Yes, I had the jeans didn't work out too much because I went into partnership with somebody that was shiesty. So, you know, we ended up, you know, losing the business. Then I had a store where I sold phones, computers, printers, accessories and stuff. Like I always been, you know, into business and stuff like that. And, you know, I was working in the ministry for this organization down here. You know, I was taking care of a ministry they had, you know, out in the campo. And in 2015, I started recording my teachings and putting them on TV. And I used to pay like $200 a month to this TV stations to run my teachings through their programming. And then the owner of the TV station saw me being interviewed on one of the programs on the station, and he was like, "Hey, you know, you're pretty good." I was like, "I don't speak Spanish that well." And he was like, "If most of the people that have TV programs spoke it the way you speak it, I'll be a happy man." And I was like, "You know what? I'm gonna find me a broadcasting school so I could learn how to speak Spanish better and speak better, you know." So I found this broadcasting school in 2015. 2 months later, I accepted his offer and I started a TV program called Lo Mejor TV.
So Lo Mejor TV on YouTube started as a program?
As a TV program.
And you were on a TV channel?
On a TV channel. Lo Mejor TV was like Good Morning America, something like that. Or the Spanish version, Despierta America from Univision. We used to do cooking and doctors and all that stuff. I'm gonna send you some pictures.
A TV show.
It was just like the.
So you had production. You had.
Yeah,
you
had production. Capital, yeah. Like business, everything. I had chefs coming in there. We was on TV every day for 2 hours. I won. You see that trophy over there? That nickel plated trophy. I won that as the best Christian program on TV.
So it was a Christian, at first it was a Christian business?
We didn't talk about Christians, but we didn't have no cursing or nothing like
no
that.
No cursing.
But it was just like Despierta America, talking a lot of shit.
So how do you guys get on, like, do you transition onto YouTube?
I ended up going to this businessman to get sponsorship, who knew me, and he gave me the sponsorship, but he also told me, he knew I was a hustler. He said, "If I offer you a job, will you come work for me?" I said, "Sure." So he offered me a job that, you know, I just couldn't refuse. So I ended up closing Lo Mejor TV, and I went to work as sales manager in Haiti for like 3 years.
Were you living in Haiti?
No, I used to go every week. Stay over there for three days.
What was that business about? I was very interested because of how Haiti is.
The free zone again. I was selling zippers, lining, toilet paper, soap.
To companies or to people?
To companies. The people that made, you know, they wasn't making jeans no more. It was more T-shirts. But, you know, Old Navy, damn, I keep forgetting the names when I'm talking about it.
And then you start running, and then you get into that for yourself, no?
No. What happened was that I got my pizza shop. So I started my pizza shop in 2020. 3 months later, pandemic came. So I had quit the job that I had, I quit it in March 19, and the world was closed March 23. So at the time, you know, everybody was shut down. Some customers started reaching out to me for other stuff, since I already had the relationship. and I would put them in contact with, you know, with whoever could and get those
time,
stuff.
The supply chain.
Yeah.
Because there was no supply. And it's crazy, you know, bro, people in America, there's a lot of people who, like, they started making, let's say they used to make 100,000, they making 300,000 now.
Because
the supply chain.
The supply chain, things changed. So these people started reaching out for me for different things that, you know, I mean, I wasn't selling them, I was just putting them in contact with whoever could get them.
It was a middleman.
Yeah, I was a middleman. And they started giving me my commission behind that. And I've been doing that ever since, bro. Throughout the pandemic, I never lacked. I was always getting mine. And after the pandemic, I said, what am I gonna do now? You know, I'm making this money, I got the pizza shop.
And is Lo Mejor Debe on YouTube at this point or no?
No, not yet. Not yet. A disciple of mine from when I was in the ministry told me, yo, you know what you should do? You seen what Tio Carlos did? And I was like, hell no. Stupid? Shit, that was 35 years ago. I don't want to talk about that shit. And he was like, nah, nigga. But you got a different story. Because you was Mike the Dome, but now you Mr. Mike. You know, you got trophies from TV producing. You've had three different businesses. You had a little factory. You had a computer store. You got a pizza shop. You wrote a book. I got a book, man. I wrote a book.
When it's coming
out? It's out. I'm going to give you one now before you leave.
And we got to put it out there for people.
It's not about my past. It's about... Is more in the way of your thing, pushing wealth, but in a biblical sense of the things King David went through before he became a king.
Oh, really?
And when he became a king, what he did after he was king. That's what the book is about. It's called No Más Migajas. In other words, in street language, we would say, no more chump change.
Does that push you to Lo Mejor Debe?
Okay, so when he told me this, and I was like, I was against it. He said, yeah, but you could use that exposure. And you know how I picture you? Having a podcast. And I was like, coño, you know, I graduated from broadcasting school. I graduated from TV producing. I mean, I went to this academy where they teach you how to produce for TV, and I graduated too. And I said, that sounds good. So one of my other disciples, he also got a podcast. And I said, yo, listen, I want to start a podcast. What do I need? He says, what's your budget? He says, forget about that. What do I need? And he was the one that told me, buy this, buy that, buy that. I'll teach you how to edit, and you take off from there. You already know about TV producing. So I went to this interview. As a matter of fact, I didn't even ask for it. Homie told me about, you know, how he viewed me as being a podcaster. And a week later, Colombia Alcantara calls out through Twitter. She sends me a DM. She says, yo, Mike, listen, I'm trying to interview people that have been, you know, and I was like, damn.
And so people don't know, she's like one of the top.
So when I came out and gave her my testimony, almost like 500,000 views, bro.
You know what's crazy? I did my research and I didn't find that.
You didn't find that? I'm gonna send you the link.
Yeah, I did a lot
of research. It's a little bit like what you and me talking about, but in Spanish. A little bit more, you know, lighter. Because she didn't come from New York. She was like shocked, you know? But we spoke for more than an hour, and you know, almost 500,000 people saw that. So then on December of 2021, I recorded my first video. I was like, you know, I'm gonna start talking bullshit because I noticed a lot of people were edified with my interview from Colombia. Maybe I could be of some help to you. And, hey, man, people wasn't watching. People don't want to hear that shit. So then one day I started talking about Alofoque, and I had like maybe 150 subscribers, and I got like 6,500 views.
They say that, that's what he's always saying, that, yeah, that he's the algorithm.
Yeah, yeah. So I said, oh, so that's how it is. So then I just started talking about him and the people around him. And, you know, a couple of months later, I got to 1,000 subscribers, 4,000 hours view time. And I started making money. I said, whoa, I got 5,000 and change now. And like I told you, you know, I saw the future.
I've seen that Alofoque, which to people who don't know is one of the, well, is the biggest YouTuber in the Dominican Republic. Yeah. And he's dominating the Latin market.
Yeah.
That he's shouted you out and he's showed love to you.
Yeah.
How does that feel to be recognized by the top YouTuber of this country? When you know, in retrospect, you didn't start La Mejor TV just yesterday, but you did start YouTube just yesterday.
Yeah. He met me because he's the type of dude that navigates on YouTube to see who's talking about him. And he saw one of my videos. And as you can see, you know, I know how to decorate my shit. And he saw me and he found it strange that somebody that's old enough to be his father was giving him his props. You know, him coming from the hood and being where he's at. And he was like, damn. And he saw, like, you know, my shit looked nice. So he already knew who I was, but he didn't say nothing. When his beer came out, I started selling combos on the pizza shop. You get a medium pie, two beers, whatever. He found out about it, and he shouted me out on his Instagram. And then he came and he saw my video, and he made a comment with his Alofoque Radio Network tag, and he said, yo, falling in love with this podcast.
Saludo a Mike allí en Santiago, lo mejor podcast, mi podcast favorito.
And then he said on another video, you know what? I want you to interview me on this podcast. And I was like, for real? He says, yeah. And then he shouted me out in Instagram, saying, amo este podcast.
And he invited you to a launch that he was doing.
Yeah, yeah. He said, amo este podcast. And when he said that, I said, damn, man, thank you for the shout out, you know, because a lot of people started, like 400 people subscribed to my channel. I went from 1,000 to 1,500 in one day. And I said, yo, thanks for the shout out, man. He says, you know what? I appreciate you. Here's my number. And I said, here's my number. So I went to, you know, to put his name on my phone. And when I went to put his name on my phone, he already had text me through WhatsApp. He goes, Santiago, on this side. I was like, oh, shit, yo, man, I admire you, whatever. And after that, homie just started calling me at night because he be up 2 in the morning and shit like that. He started calling me and, you know, he used to be talking to me in this group chats and stuff like that until one day he called me. I guess he already knew of my past and stuff like that. He called me to tell me, you know, some problems he was having at home. And my ministry side came into play there. I guess my counseling did what they had to do. And ever since then, he didn't call me no more in group chats. He only called me privately. And he started talking to me about his mom's, you know, about personal things in his family and stuff like that. And I would kick it with him and, you know, give him some knowledge. And
just OG shit.
Yeah.
OG shit.
And he would always tell me, yo, man, he would tell me in Spanish, oye, yo aprecio tu amistad. So he's always saying, Saludo a Mike, de lo mejor TV podcast, mi podcast favorito. He probably don't even watch it, you know, but he's always saying that, you know, mi podcast favorito. And a lot of people watch my channel because of that shout outs that he gives me.
What do you think about him?
He crazy. he crazy. Homie be, you know, pepped up because he be having to, you know, he be having to drink pills to sleep and stuff like that. So I'm like, nigga, you a tecato, motherfucker. You just legally, you're a legal one. You know, you got your doctor giving you medication and stuff like that. And I told him one day, are you the way you are because you might be, you know, high on that medication you get? Because you be doing some crazy shit sometimes and saying some crazy shit. He goes, nah.
But he's gotten better, though.
Yeah. You know, but I haven't spoken to him in a while, you know. Right now, he in Europe, he be telling me, you know, that's where he needs to rest his mind and stuff, that, you know, Spain is the place to be. Because when he goes to New York or Miami, it's still the same thing.
Yeah, it's Dominican.
So that, you know, he went to Spain and he chilling out there. I haven't spoken to him in a while. I don't know if I'm still in his agenda no more, but I really don't give a fuck. You know what I'm saying? But homie, he, you know, he shows me love, and that's much appreciated. Being that, you know, that I'm doing YouTube now, he gives me advice on things to do. He gives me content sometimes. Like, yo, talk about this, talk about that. And, you know, whenever he does, I be getting them views, bro. I be getting them views.
Do you think that the success of Lo Mejor TV has also been that you've done different content? Like, I see you were doing reactions with your son, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That's pretty dope. Like, yeah. The people out here don't do that.
No.
They just started getting into that game.
Yeah, yeah. We're doing reaction on Sirius and stuff like that. But he's still sleeping. So I'm like 7 o'clock in the morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, I'm drinking coffee, looking at what can I talk about, you know what I'm saying? So I can't depend on somebody else's agenda.
So you get into the Heights podcast where you interviewing a lot of legends, yes, and giving these stories. Your goal is to reach 1,000 subscribers and monetize.
Yeah, I got like 521 right now. I need 479 to get the 1,000 subscribers.
And when you reach the 1,000 subscribers, you are gonna release a couple interviews with a couple legends.
Because
that's gonna really.
I don't see the point of doing it now for entertainment if I'm not gonna make a buck out of it. You know what I'm saying? So either, you know, if I'm gonna get the 1,000 subscribers, I'm gonna get them out of talking shit.
Nope.
Cause I got a lot of niggas lined up, you know.
A lot of legends.
And I'm like, let's wait till I get to 1,000 subscribers, because if I get 1,000, 2,000, 5,000, 10,000, whatever 1,000 type of views I get, if I get them now, it's gonna be for nothing. But if I get them when I got 1,000 subscribers, I could make at least 10, 20, 50, 100 bucks out of it, you know? And I'm planning on maybe throwing out an interview once a week. There's a lot of deported motherfuckers down here.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? It's crazy because there's this guy, he's part of Fat Joe crew.
Okay.
His name is Pistol Pete. He's legendary in the Bronx because he really put in that work. Yeah, he did a lot of jail time. He has a podcast, it's called Dog in the Yard in New York.
Dog in the Yard?
Yeah, so he talk about, check it out. Okay. It's all about like niggas who done time.
Yeah.
And talking about their experiences. And I commented recently, I'm like, yo, you should come out to the yard. There's 1,000 deported niggas.
Yeah.
And that'd be great stories too. But he probably is doing them people he has a relationship with.
That's how it is. That's how it is.
But what I'm saying, like, that's
because I'm saving the good ones.
For the
ones I get the 1,000. You know what I'm saying? Because I did a little clip. I even took it out, you know, with Lenny. But I was like, man, I'm not going to interview you so people could just enjoy it and shit.
And the niche, bro, that niche is crazy because there's a lot of YouTube that they just cater to, like, talking about street mm-hmm, stuff that happened. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, a little bit more in a story time. As a person who's been through all these trials and tribulations, you've been through addiction, you've been a dealer, you've done time, you've changed your life. What advice do you have for the kids or the youth who are out here in the streets and they want to maybe change their life, but they don't know how to?
if they're into the drug game, it's very difficult to tell somebody right now to leave it.
It's a bigger game that has a
standard. Yeah, if they're doing good at it. Usually people don't ask for advice when they, you know, running the streets. But usually when you hit rock bottom, that's when you say, like, you know, what can I do? You know, in my case, I knew that if something supernatural didn't happen, it was gonna be impossible for me to leave the streets, because I have been in the streets since the age of 12. You know what I'm saying? And the only thing that helped me was God. Only because of God, because deep down inside of me, I still wanna walk the streets. But God has...
It's a daily battle.
Yeah, God has...
I fight it every day.
God has given me...
That strength?
Yeah, the strength to do what I gotta do so I could put bread on the table for my kids, you know? So if anything, you know, seek God, man, and God will do what he has to do.
I wanna ask you this, because I asked I had this debate with someone who calls himself an OG. I feel like the OGs that were of the 80s, 90s, like, a lot of people were selfish as well, obviously. But, like, people threw parties for kids. People, sometimes, not all of them, but some, you know, did the barbecues for the kids, even if they have ulterior motives. Like, I feel like you can't, in this day and age, if you left the streets or whatever, you can't call yourself an OG unless you try and do something better for you, for the people behind you now. I don't know if you agree with that, because at the end of the day, like, a person said, like, OGs are whoever put in work in the streets for a long time ago. Do you feel like OGs or people who are older who left the street life behind have a responsibility to at least teach the kids that are coming forward or try to give some game back?
I didn't have the opportunity to do it in the States, but I did it down here. We didn't talk about that. Once I saw a way out, I opened up a program called the Potter's House, where I helped the deported niggas, niggas that came out of prison, and addicts. We would bring them in there, we would feed them, and we would teach them how to leave the drugs alone. It's still running strong. My brother runs the program now. And this was my way of giving back after all the things that
you
I did.
You should do some content with that. Not, it doesn't have to do with the people, but with the program. Like,
we're gonna do some content, you know, because we got a lot of dudes that, you know, that come there, that come from the States, you know, still be fucking around down here. And,
yeah, cause that's very
and
important.
Girls too. They be having girls in there. But it's like a prison, man. You know what I'm saying? I don't mess around with it no more. I started it back in 2000, but I stay away. I guess it messes with my mind. You know what I'm saying?
Seeing people go.
Yeah, through. Yeah. But I helped a couple of guys that right now they you know, some are lawyers.
That's dope. That's dope.
Yeah.
So you feel like you have that responsibility?
Yeah. I think I did what I had to do, you know, and that was the best way of doing it. You know what I'm saying? It's called the Potter's House. It's like a rehabilitation program.